Camps 5 and 6. Because of our late start, I thought Camp 4 was close, but we didn't get to the dreaded wall leading up to it until well after dark. "We're climbing the wall at night?" I asked, shocked. Zopa took off his mask. "It's the only way to get to Camp 4 unnoticed. Everyone will be asleep." They would be in their tents all right. The wind was howling, and it hadn't stopped snowing all day. But from our last experience, I knew that they wouldn't be sleeping. If they were like me when I was up there, they would be lying in their sleeping bags, wondering if there was enough air to keep them alive through the night. The last time we were here, it took me over 5 hours to reach the top, and I nearly gave up on the way. The weather was worse now, and it was dark. Yogi and Yash had thrown a rope over the side for us to use.
"You'll need the headlamps," Zopa said.
"Right," I said. "Slide the Jumar up the rope. Step. Breathe. Jumar. Step. Jumar. Think. Look up. Think again. Step. Rest. 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 Hug the wall. Pray." The same routine. But in a strange way, the climb was easier, or at least less scary, with the headlamp. The light kept me focused on the ice and the rock in front of me. I had no idea where the top or the bottom was until a light appeared over the edge about 10 feet above me. It was Yogi, although it was hard to tell, bundled up like he was. I managed to get to the top without his having to grab me. As I rested on my knees trying to catch my breath and not puke, I looked at my watch. I had climbed the wall in less than 5 hours this time. 15 minutes later, Sunjo came over the top, looking like he was about to pass out. I shouted in his ear that he had made it up the wall a half hour faster than he had the last time. This seemed to cheer him up. He managed to get to his feet. Zopa was last. He was in terrible shape. It took all three of us to pull him over the edge, and when we got him there, he didn't move. I checked his oxygen tank. It was empty. Yogi hurried off and came back with a fresh tank and Yash. They got O's flowing and carried Zopa to the tent. After an hour or so, he recovered enough to open his eyes and drink something. A few minutes later, he asked the brothers if they had heard anything from Josh. The Chinese soldier climbers had reached ABC that afternoon and were planning on staying there a day or two before climbing to Camp 4. They had checked everyone's papers and searched all the tents. The climbers at ABC said the soldiers were in great shape and had made terrific time. There was no doubt that they were going to try for the summit. This seemed like the worst possible news, but Zopa didn't seem to be at all disturbed by it.
"You will be a day ahead of them. Tonight and tomorrow, you will rest. The following morning, before light, you will climb to Camp 5.
"What about you?" Sunjo asked.
"Do you really think they are going to be worried about the sick old monk when they get up here? If they were really such good climbers, the soldiers would want to try for the summit. Which of them will stay behind to escort the old man down the mountain?"
He gave me a wheezy laugh.
"By the time that they get back here, I will be gone.
Why can't we just go up to Camp 5 when it gets light?" I asked. "Will be just that much farther ahead of the soldiers."
"There will be a storm in a few hours," Zopa answered. "Tomorrow morning is your window."
The storm hit us mid-morning. If we had left when I wanted, we would have been about halfway to Camp 5. And then we would have died, along with the three other climbers who did leave that morning. None of them made it to Camp 5, and nobody could help them. The weather was too severe. I tried to write in my Moleskine and found that I couldn't concentrate long enough to string more than two or three words together at a time. After a while, I gave up and managed to get a little sleep, and so did Sunjo, mostly because there was nothing else to do but lie in the tent. Zopa didn't want us running around the camp, not that we had the energy, and the storm was so bad, everyone there was hunkered down waiting for it to stop. About 8 o'clock that night, it did, suddenly. One moment, the wind and the snow were threatening to blow our tent away. The next moment, it was perfectly calm. I stuck my head outside the tent and along with everyone else in the camp, and we saw a perfectly clear sky overhead scattered with bright stars. Yash left for camp 5 3 hours ahead of us to get the camp ready. Yogi stuck his head into our tent an hour before we were to leave and told us to pack our gear. We weren't taking much with us. Most of what we needed would be waiting for us at Camp 5. Yogi and Yash had hauled it up the last time that we were at Camp 4. Before we took off, we checked in with Zopa. He was sitting up, drinking a mug of tea. He was off the O's, and some of the color had returned to his face, but he still looked pretty weak.
Speed is everything now. If you stay in the death zone too long, you will die. If you don't reach the summit by 1:35 p.m., the day you leave the Camp 6, I have asked Yogi and Yash to turn you around. It is better to get cut by the Chinese than to die in the mountain.
This seemed to contradict his plan to get Sunjo over the top to safety, but he was right. From Camp 6, you have to reach the summit and return in about 8 hours. Oxygen or not, there was a limit to how long you could survive above Camp 6. If we made the summit, we would either have to reach the top camp on the other side in 18 hours. Have Yogi and Yash been to the summit? I asked. It had been a question on my mind since Zopa had announced that he was taking us there himself.
Of course, Zopa said, 3 times.
Good, I said. Does Josh know that you're not coming with us? Zopa shook his head, then gave us a blessing, and said,
I'll see you both in Kathmandu. Now go.
It was clear and bitterly cold as we left the dark camp and started up the north ridge to the summit. It was hard to keep my excitement in check. At night, at Camp 5, and a night at Camp 6, then the top of the world. It was more of a forced march to Camp 5 than a climb. We hooked onto a series of fixed ropes. Yogi set the pace. I tried a regimen of 12 steps, a minute of gasping to recover, then another 12 steps. After an hour, it was down to about 8 steps, and I'm not sure how many minutes to recover. It was hard to believe that some climbers had made it to the summit without any supplemental O's at all. Josh was one of them, although I suspected on this trip he would be sucking down the O's, if for no other reason than to stay sharp so he didn't lose one of his clients. The summit came up and gave us the best view of Everest's pyramidal summit yet. It was enormous. Coming off the top was a disk of ice crystals against a blue sky. The sight inspired my sluggish brain to remember the camera which I had put in my pocket before we left Camp 4. I shouted ahead to Sunjo to wait up, which he was more than happy to do. When I got to him, I took out my outer mittens, pushed the record button, and tried to imitate JR as best I could. "What are you feeling right now?" I asked. "You're less than a mile from the highest point on Earth." I had him framed perfectly against the summit.
"Frightened," Sunjo said, "and hopeful, and worried about my grandfather. I had no idea it would be this hard. That's about all my unmitted fingers could take."
"I can film you now if you'd like," Sunjo offered.
"Nah, that's all right. We have to get moving."
About a half an hour later, we saw our first corpse. Sunjo saw it first. I walked up to him as he was staring down at it. Yogi had breezed by it as if he hadn't noticed, but I bet he had. It was a woman. About 50 feet away was another corpse, but I couldn't tell what it was because it was lying face down. I had never seen a dead person, let alone a frozen dead person. She looked more like a wax figure than a former human being, and in a way, this was even more disturbing to me. She had been there for a while, if her shredded clothes were any indication. It looked like she had died sitting up and had fallen over on her side. She was only a few hours from her tent at Camp 4. I'm not sure how long we stood there staring, and we would have stood there a lot longer if Yogi hadn't shouted at us to hurry up. After 5 more corpses, I stopped looking. At noon, we came up to the steeper part of the North Ridge. It was much colder. The fixed ropes were frozen, and the Sherpas had chipped shallow steps into the ice to make it easier to climb. Yogi waited for us to catch up to him. He pointed to the tents down at Camp 4, then up to the tents at Camp 5 and said something in Nepalese.
"Halfway," Sunjo translated. 6 hours to go."
To make that 6 hours worse, the wind picked up. We had to bend over as we climbed so that we weren't blown off the ridge. My initial excitement was long gone. I think the only thing that kept me going were the O's waiting for me up ahead. I don't know what kept Sunjo going, probably the Chinese climbers behind him, and Freedom ahead. We got to Camp 5 a little before 7, 25,196 feet. It seemed impossible that we could go any farther. It was the end of the world. It really wasn't a camp. It was a series of cleared platforms stretching up the north ridge for at least a quarter mile, with absolutely no shelter from the howling wind. The big platforms could hold 5 or 6 tents, small platforms 1 or 2. Several of the platforms had tents on them, but it was hard to say how many people were there. I suspected most of the tents were waiting for climbers coming up from Camp 4 or down from Camp 6 after the summit attempt. Our tiny rubble pile was just big enough for 2 tents pitched on the garbage of former occupants. Yash had water boiling for tea, but what I was interested in was the mass strapped to his face, pumping O's into his lungs. He was moving twice as fast as we were. I grabbed a tank from the pile, pulled the mask out of my pack, hooked it up, and stuck my face in it. The feeling I had was the first lungful of oxygen is indescribable. Bliss is about as close as I could come, but it was way beyond that. Yash helped Sunjo set up his rig, and when we got it on, we looked at each other and started laughing. We were going to live. We might even make it to the summit. The Chinese are heading up to Camp 4 tomorrow, one of the climbers from ABC told Josh. You're kidding, Josh said. What about acclimatization? These guys are acclimated. One of our climbers speaks a little Chinese. They told her they were up on K2 and they were ordered to come here. They haven't said it, but I don't think that they're coming back down until they take a shot at the summit. They're like climbing machines. When are you heading up? The day after tomorrow, if the weather's good, Josh answered. I was going to hold off a little bit longer, but I took my people out for a climb today, and they all did pretty well. The virus seems to have run its course. We're heading up to Camp 4 in the morning. We'll see you on the way back down. Good luck. Out. This was probably the last transmission we would hear. I wondered if Josh would be worried when he didn't pass me on his way up. I asked Sunjo how he was doing. The oxygen helps, but I'm still concerned. I had a lot of trouble today. You're not the only one. It's hard up here. I have to make it, he said, for my sisters and my mother. Those were great reasons to risk your life, I thought. But why was I doing it? For Josh's business? For my ego? Now that my brain had oxygen, I found myself really missing the 2 P's, my mom and even Rolf. This got me thinking about the corpses that we saw on the way up here. Who had they left behind? These were very uncomfortable questions to fall asleep on. The oxygen was wonderful, but the masks were a pain in the butt to sleep in. It was hard to find a position where the straps didn't dig into your face. Also, the exhaust system stank. Small pools of icy slime collected in the mouthpiece valve. When I moved my head, slushy spit ran down my neck. Because of this, Sunjo and I were up early. We had checked and rechecked our gear. Leaving something behind like a spare headlamp battery or a glove could be a death sentence. Yogi took the lead this time, leaving Yash to take us up to Camp 6. Our first obstacle was a steep snowfield that we had to 4-point with ice axes and crampons. Stupidly, I assumed that now that we were on the O's, it would be like climbing at sea level. Nothing could be further from the truth. By the time we reached the top of the snowfield, my lungs were screaming for air. I thought that there was something the matter with my mask or that the tank had run out of oxygen, but everything was working perfectly. The 2 liters of oxygen didn't simulate at sea level. It simply allowed me to stay alive above 25,000 feet. And there was a huge difference between lying in a tent doing virtually nothing and climbing a steep snowfield on all fours. I took the little camera out and filmed Sunjo crabbing his way up to me. By the expression on his face, I could see he was having the same oh revelation I just had. I don't think I can make it, he gasped. I'm serious, Peek. This is too much. We just pushed it too hard going up the field, I said with a confidence I didn't feel. We'll just have to pace ourselves. He nodded, but there was fear in his eyes. I knew exactly how he felt. We had passed another 3 or 4 corpses on the way up. A few hours later, I stopped to rest and looked at my altimeter watch. We had just passed 26,000 feet, and we were officially in the death zone. Every minute from now on, we were dying a little. We stumbled into Camp 6 like 3 zombies. Yogi had the tent set up, but he didn't look much better than we did. He told Sanjo to get our stove going to boil snow and to drink as much water as we could. The very idea of drinking or eating anything made my stomach lurch. I turned on the video camera and shot Sanjo lighting the stove or trying to light the stove. It must have taken him 15 strokes to get the cigarette lighter going in the thin air. When it finally ignited, his thumb was bleeding like he had sliced it open with a knife. We gagged down as much water and food as we could, then strapped up our sleeping bags to wait. Sleep was out of the question. The inside of the tent was filled with a thin layer of frost from our breath. Every time one of us moved, the freezing crystals fell on our faces. They say that when you die, your life flashes before your eyes. Mine was passing before my eyes in slow motion like a horror movie. I think it was the corpses that did it. I thought of Mom falling off the wall, the boy I'd never met falling off the Flatron building, Sanjo hanging by a thread on an ice wall, and Sanjo's father saving my father, then dying of heart failure. The only thing that stopped the depressing playback was the tent flap opening and the appearance of Yogi's masked face. "We go," he said. Well, not quite. It was more like, "We get ready to go." They made us drink more water. Then they told us to do our toilet, which was a lot easier said than done at 30 degrees below zero. 2 hours later, we were ready. We left for the summit of Mount Everest. I looked at my watch. It was 1:35 a.m. We had 12 hours to get there.